In this movie, I would like to show you step-by-step how to use the basic authoring technique to create our four-page SparkLab. Although I'll be using the Sparkvue application on computer, this same technique can be used with the Spark Science Learning System device and no computer. Before I start actually authoring, I'd like to take a closer look at the final product, the final SparkLab I'll create. What I'd like to do is look more closely at the page elements. You'll discover shortly that when we construct a SparkLab page, we're basically taking certain page elements and putting them on the page, much like building blocks. So I'd like to walk through and identify each of the page elements on the four pages. We can start on page one, the title page, and we see that the left two-thirds of the page is occupied by a large image. And there's some text in the upper right. This page has two page elements, a small text box in the upper right and a large image element on the left. Page 2, again, has two page elements. This time it's two large text boxes, one in the top half and one on the bottom half of the page. On page 3, we have three page elements. There is a small text box in the upper right and two data displays. There's a large graph of temperature versus time on the left two-thirds of the screen and a small digits display of temperature in the lower right. Finally, page 4 has the same two page elements and the same design as page 2, that is, two large text boxes, one atop the other. All right, now that we've taken a look at the final lab, I'm going to go ahead and construct it. I'll begin by launching the SparkVue software. And connecting the sensor I'll be using for this experiment, in this case, a temperature probe. Now, whenever we build our own original experiments in SparkVue, we choose from the home screen the Build button. And this brings us to the Build page. We'll be using this build page to construct each page of the SparkLab, so let's take a close look at its elements. Starting at the top, we can see there are four data displays: graph, digits, table, and meter. There are page elements for images, large and small, and text boxes, large and small. Now, there are two columns. The items on the left column are large page elements occupying more space on the page than the small elements on the right. You'll notice that the data displays in the top are all grayed out. That's because we'd first need to use this column on the left of measurements to identify what measurement we'd like to see in the data display before we use it. Finally, on the right third of the page, we see a preview window. This page is going to fill with the page elements as we construct the page. So I'm going to start by creating page one, and we have two page elements on this page. You may recall a large image on the left and a small text box in the upper right. We generally construct SparkLab pages from upper left to lower right, so I'll begin by adding a large image. Now initially, SparkVue is going to put this as occupying the whole page, but you'll see in a moment that it's going to intelligently downsize as we add additional elements. So the only other element we have on this page, in the upper right, we'd like to have a text entry box. So I'll choose a small text entry box, and now we have those two page elements on the page as we intend them to be configured. All right, this page looks good, so I'll press OK to build it. And looks like we got the page we're looking for. I'm going to quickly type in the title of our lab here. Okay. And I'm going to fill this image element with the actual image I'd like. So I'm going to click and open up my file navigator and select the image that I'd like to occupy that space. Once I'm confident that's the image I'd like, I can lock that. And we're done with page one. Now, when you build a new SparkLab, it always starts with a single page. So I'm on page one. If I'd like to add a page two, all I need to do is press this new page icon. And I go back to the build page. So on page two, I again have two page elements, but this time around I'd like two large text boxes, one in the upper half and the other in the bottom half of the screen. So I'll choose a large text box from this left column and a second large text box. And that's the design I'm looking for. I'll press OK to build it. And this is going to be a page of background information on the top. And I'll speed through this typing. And after that background information, I'll ask a question for students to make a prediction. Okay, the top box is complete. The bottom box is intended for students to make their prediction. I'll save them a little bit of typing by adding some leading text. And they can simply complete that sentence with their prediction. All right, page two is complete. On to page three, build new page. Now on page three, we're going to have three page elements. You may recall there's a graph of temperature versus time on the left two-thirds of the page, a small text box of instructions in the upper right, and a small digits display in the lower right. So beginning on the left, I need to add a graph. And graph, of course, is not available until I choose the measurement from the column on the left. So I'll first select temperature, then a graph from the center column, and I have a graph. This will be a graph of temperature versus time. Next up will be, in the upper right, a small text entry box. And finally, I'd like to have a small digits display. So I'll choose temperature again and digits to complete the page. And in this text entry box, I will type in the instructions for collecting data. Okay, so the instructions are complete and this page is finished. On to the last page, page four, build new page. And this page, we're simply going to have two large text boxes, one on top of the other. So large text box, another large text box, and okay. And this will be the conclusion page. And once again, I'll provide some leading text in the bottom for students to respond. Okay. Let me page back through, just visually scanning these pages to make sure they look okay. I didn't miss anything. And they look like they're okay. So what I'd like to do now is save this file as it currently is. So I'll go to the sharing button in the upper right, choose to save this file as, and I'll give it a descriptive name. And let me call it basic to remind myself that this is the lab I created using the basic authoring technique. Now, a quick aside, I didn't pay much attention to the size of my screen as I was creating this, and that's fine for SparkVue users. But if I did intend for this SparkLab to be used by Spark Science Learning System device users, I would want to first come in here and tell SparkVue to automatically resize the screen optimized for the smaller SLS display. All right. But I'm happy with the SparkVue version, so I'll choose Save. And I've now saved a version of this SparkLab. Now, before I actually distribute this, I probably should go through and test its functionality. So I'm going to walk through it as a student might, interacting with anything that's interactive. So I'll have a response here. Make sure everything works. And on page three, I'll actually collect some data following these instructions. So I'll begin by placing the temperature sensor in the juice. Starting data collection. And we can see the data appears on both the graph and the digits displays. And I'll add the tablet and scale the graph so we can better see any changes in temperature. And it looks like I'm beginning to see a decrease in temperature. So I'll let that run until the reaction ends. All right, the temperature is stabilizing, the bubbling has stopped, so I'll stop data collection. And it looks like page three works as intended. On to the final page, page four. And as a student might, I'll respond to this conclusion. I think we've tested the functionality of our lab. It looks like it works. So now that I have confidence in it, I can go back to the version I saved before data collection and distribute that to my students. In this movie, we've seen how we can use the basic authoring technique and the SparkVue software alone to fairly quickly create a functional SparkLab. Now, this lab works fine, and I think it conveys the idea, but it does look a bit plain. So, in the next movie, I'm going to show you how the enhanced authoring technique can be used to make a SparkLab that looks even better.